Your host, Dr. Craig, and we're broadcasting, as always, out of Edge Radio Studios in Nipaluna, Hobart, Tasmania. On this show, we explore how media can shape our understanding of the world around us, and we're streaming, as always, on edgeradio.org.au, as well as YouTube and Twitch for those that want to see us, or me, in the flesh. We will be also accepting messages, if you want, through the SMS channel 0488117077 or via the chat on YouTube or Twitch. Today we're going to look at some interesting news articles which have passed my eyes over the last week, as well as some ideas around the art of introducing content interestingly. All that and more on Media Mothership here on Edge Radio. So, first off the ranks, there's been quite a bit of media news, of course, around AI, which is always fascinating to look at. The main article I want to start with is one from the ABC News looking at artificial intelligence technologies, which could be classified as being a risk, and how governments are going to consult on AI regulation to hopefully address some concerns around the impact they might be having on society and possibly the ability to write convincingly if some of the panics coming out of reporting on school systems is anything to go by. So they're looking at introducing safeguards. Last week we looked at the classification schemes which are getting rolled out around all the new classification schemes, the updating of the classification schemes, which are happening on the videos and movies, you know, adding some new contextual information to them. And it looks like, yeah, similarly, an attempt to classify the risks which might be used in some of these AI programs. Looking very interesting. I mean, certainly there's been a number of tech experts as well as, CEOs of these very companies waving red flags around the concerns they might have of their use, such as some of the deep faking of voices and images, which might lead to malicious attacks or scams occurring. So it'll be interesting to see how this is reacting to. There's also been, of course, ideas of some governments being frightful of being left behind. So the hope of, restraining AI technology, but then also not wanting to be left behind with some of the advances with AI technology. So it'll be fascinating to see how that develops. And of course, on Media Mothership, we'll do our best to also incorporate those trends in our creation of the show. The other news story I quickly want to mention is one that's been getting a lot of interest, which is around a lawyer who had used ChatGPT to, create some citations for his paperwork that he'd submitted into a court in the US and was later called out on it by the judge, who couldn't find the references and citations that this document was referring to. And it turned out that ChatGPT, well, this lawyer had used ChatGPT and it had hallucinated, as they say. It had hallucinated these references and sources, added it to the document that was submitted in court, and the lawyer had not double-checked that these sources, if these sources are real, if they exist, and simply submitted it. And, of course, had been found out. So, really, it's a case of, I guess, you know, not really understanding the limitations of the technology as ChatGPT, Bing AI have these provisos that their conversation, discourse, kind of bots, they're not actually they need to be verified. They need to be double checked. They shouldn't be the one and only source of information. And certainly going back and looking at the references is key. So there's hopefully not going to be too many examples of that.
The hook.
The next bit of news is again about AI and media, but this one is the headline: the City of Melbourne's urban forest project turns out has been attracting weekly love letters to the trees. This is an article talking about how email addresses were given to each of the trees in this particular Melbourne urban forest project. And those emails were there to assist with maintenance. They were kind of used to, I assume, update on the kind of health, the fertilizer, the watering and so forth, I imagine, of each tree. But then that email address was public knowledge. So it turns out people began to email trees they considered their favorites in this park and started emailing love letters, poems to these trees, which is, yeah, a gorgeous idea. It'd be fascinating to see if, you know, an internal email system had been used or an email system had been used for objects more broadly that was serving one purpose in terms of, you know, being able to create some kind of mailing list for structural maintenance or some form of maintenance, but then people being able to get that information. So, you know, there's a wonderful example of one of the emails here. We'll try to see if we can
City of Melbourne's
example.
Urban Forest Project still attract.
Yep. So there's one example that I want to read here. We'll see how that one sounds.
Dear tree number 1517937, I'm confessing something very dear to me. I have fallen in love with tree number 1583182. I also feel guilty for cheating. I honestly feel really bad, and I don't know what to do. Would be really great if you could give me some advice. Regards, tree lover.
So there's one of the anonymous admirers to a tree. So let's read one other email that had been sent to a tree here. So here's a second example of just a general member of the public who had been able to access the email of specific trees in this park project in Melbourne and surprising the staff when they discovered emails were being sent to them. So here's another example of it.
Babe, I am sorry that you're so sick. Can I climb you one last time? Strip down that bark for me, baby. It'll make you feel better.
So even some risque material being emailed to trees such as this poor sick tree with the email asking if they could climb the tree one last time. Unusual, very unusual. So again, yeah, it's fascinating to hear these love letters and poems that surprised the staff that were maintaining these trees and were amazed at the letters that were coming in. And this has been going on, it turns out, for about 10 years. Absolutely amazing. So amazing stories there of from Edge Radio. Yeah, so you're listening to Media Mothership here on Edge Radio. And as people will have seen on our live stream, we've been joined by Lord Taylor again. Hey, Taylor.
I've been here the entire time. I've just been really quiet.
Have you? How are you?
Hello.
Oh, is that guest two Hello. Mic? No, I've actually turned your mic on. That's right. Well, maybe that was the problem. I'd not turned your mic
there
on.
There we go.
Had you... I've just done a great story. about there are these trees in a park in Melbourne which had been given individual email addresses.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, mainly for maintenance, so that I'm assuming gardeners would know which trees have been fertilized. But the general public got access to these email addresses and started sending them love letters and poems. Some of them were quite risque. I read out one or two risque one, which I'm sure no SMSs from the manager yet.
Brilliant.
So yeah, would you if you found out that, like, maybe we should get a we've got an email address for edgeradio.org.au, mm-hmm. but maybe we should have an email address for the actual studio.
Yeah.
Right. And we use it internally for maintenance, right? So we email it. We include the studio in the email list for reasons.
There should be one.
Well, already. There's one for Edge Radio, the business.
No, but there's one that comes up on here.
Live. The SMS one?
No, there's an SMS one and there's an email as well. There should be.
Oh, there is too. It says studio at Edge Radio. Let me look across a bit. Yeah. Studio at edgeradio.org.au. I mean, who reads that? Is that? There you go. Well, if you want to write a love poem to the actual studio.
Yeah, and it should appear on the screen. So.
Oh, right. This is a bit like that Doctor Who episode where the TARDIS got a voice. Do you see that
yeah,
one?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And I think it was a Neil Gaiman?
Yeah, I believe it was, yeah.
Written episode? Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it was weird, profoundly weird, when you're thinking of, well, this was an inanimate object, I thought, but it has a consciousness to it.
Yeah.
So in a way, yeah, maybe. I mean, we've just been talking about over the last few weeks how AI, people are saying it's kind of weird how lifelike AI can be. I mean, it's not lifelike yet. It hasn't yet attained singularity or consciousness. But it responds in ways that can fool some humans.
Some.
Never me. That it's real. So similarly, maybe we can jump ahead of this. And if you'd like to treat the Edge Radio Studio as a sentient being, feel free to do that. Email it directly at studio@edgeradio.org.au with your love poems or declarations of weirdness.
Brilliant.
Well, I'll just read you back one more. I mean, this is the one I thought was a bit risque. So I'll read this one again just to inspire people as to how they could email the Edge Radio.
Babe, I am sorry that you're so sick. Can I climb you one last time? Strip down that bark for me, baby. It'll make you feel better.
Yeah. I mean... I'll play that. And they're worth gold. And I think one of the things about radio is you can't go back and listen to something very easily when it's live. So I'll play the other email that they've got in this ABC story, again, to inspire people to email the radio studio of Edge, which does indeed have its own email.
Dear tree number 1517937, I'm confessing something very dear to me. I have fallen in love with tree number 1583182. I also feel guilty for cheating. I honestly feel really bad, and I don't know what to do. Would be really great if you could give me some advice. Regards, tree lover.
Yes, I mean, tree lover, I mean, it's nice. I mean, there's that phrase, you know, you're a tree hugger.
Mm-hmm.
So it's wonderful where this person has... then taken it a step further and become the tree lover.
Yeah.
And then emailed that tree to say, you know, turns out it seems that they're married.
Yeah.
So they're kind of confessing to the tree that they've been involved in cheating now.
Yeah.
Can they get help? Wow. You know, I'm inspired.
Yeah.
You know, I think individual mics could end up having their emails.
Yeah.
Right.
Guest ones never used.
Well, I'm so glad you're here, Taylor, because there is one. There's another last media news piece I want to talk about. It was one from last week that we didn't get around to, which is Australians like N-Hyphen's Jake Sim are making their mark in the competitive world of K-pop. So this was an article from last week where it went over some K-pop stuff, talking about how, yeah, there are Australians in the world of K-pop that are doing various K-pop things.
Performing, I would have said.
Yeah. What are some Australians that are in the K-pop space? Who's?
Yeah, well, Rosé from Blackpink. I don't know if she was born here, but she certainly has an Australian accent when she speaks English. There were a couple in, I can't think of, Monster X. I think they were on A Current Affair for one of their particular segments. I think they were talking to them about it. There are some dotted around everywhere. I'm not too familiar with boy bands, but I'm pretty sure there are more who are from boy groups than girl groups who are from Australia.
So there are a couple of Australians in K-pop. This ABC News story ran a little piece about it, talking about the pressures and stress that they're under. What I thought was really cute from the 5 minute, 48 second clip that was on the article was there was one little snippet they had of two Australian K-pop performers in Korea. That it seems they were on like a variety show over there, and they're, I'm assuming they've been asked to engage with some Australian teaching.
Okay, yeah.
On air. So I'm going to play this short excerpt of them performing Australia. Before I do it, what do you reckon you'd... I mean, if you were in the shoes of a, you know, 18-year-old Australian kid in a K-pop band in Korea... And they've said, okay, we'd like you to come on stage and we've got some kids and we want you to help them talk Australian.
Talk Australian.
Talk Australian. What are some phrases you think you'd teach them to talk Australian?
Your bloody drongo.
Your bloody drongo. That would be a classic. I'm going to stick my koala on you. You don't say that? You don't say you're going to... I'm snip my koala on you, mate. That one's a classic.
What else?
Getting your tinny.
Yeah.
I was in my tinny on the weekend. Yeah. Caught some fish.
I was in my tinny, holding a tinny.
You could be in your tinny, drinking a tinny.
Yeah.
That's a good phrase.
Yeah.
Yeah, you want to get in my tinny and drink... Oh, I'm not going to continue that. Yeah, so let's listen now as to what these beautiful K-pop boy performers...
Oh, dear.
...disclosed as Australian cultural identity.
So, you know, we have quite a contingent of Australians in K-pop now, and it's really exciting.
She owns... Oh, here.
Two members of band Stray Kids grew up down under.
Oh, G'day, mate.
All right, K-pop... Sorry, that was it. Okay. But K-pop band... I can forget the name of it.
Stray Kids.
Yeah. Do you know... Are they good?
Yeah, they're the ones I was talking about. I said Monster X, I meant Stray Kids.
All right, so they weren't really kind of a bit boring with just...
G'day, mate.
Did sound a little predatory. If you see the clip, it's them kind of dressed in Harry Potter gear for reasons. And two or three kids.
Wizards.
Yeah, I guess that's when many people think of who Australians are. Maybe they were confused. They're not from Britain. But yeah, there were like two, three, like six-year-old kids.
G'day, mate.
In chairs. Yeah, and they're saying it in that kind of gravelly Wolf Creek Australian yeah. voice. Like, g'day, mate. Your car's a bit busted there. You need a lift? Let's listen to it once more. What do you want to... That was my favorite. We'll listen to it once more. Okay. Is it the Wolf Creek Australian
K-pop
voice?
K-pop now, and it's really exciting.
Right. Yep.
Two members of band Stray Kids grew up down under.
G'day, mate.
Yeah, so again, I think Wolf Creek Australian.
G'day, mate.
It's
always the going up at the end of the sentences. That's what Australians mate. Do, isn't it? G'day, mate.
Yeah.
And that's all for the show.
Smooth. Okay, yeah, over the last week I've been teaching at a school here, Jordan River Senior School.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, about how to do podcasting. And I thought, why deprive people more generally of some of my knowledge, right?
Exactly.
Share.
A wealth, a font of knowledge.
So one of the things I was teaching was how to do good introductions for a podcast.
Okay.
Because I think we've nailed it on this show. How to do good introductions. And so I was looking into it again. And it turns out, like, you think one of the reasons why you want to do a good introduction is you want to grab your listener to get them to keep listening to the show. And one of the reasons that used to be given was because people have short attention spans.
Mm, yeah.
Turns out that's fake. I didn't realize this. That the alleged research that on average people have 8 seconds of attention was made up and got reported on, back in 2012 or something by a new study from Microsoft Corp. And that was the basis of it. It was Microsoft Corp that was reporting on this alleged study, which didn't exist. It was completely fake. That's... And it turned out that not only was that fake, it was also the idea that goldfish have 9 seconds attention span.
So they just,
which was also fake.
They're just making up seconds info that's just incorrect.
Yeah, it was all from a graph that was started the Smith from a company called Statistic Brain, and
why wouldn't you trust that?
Statistic Brain, it's a think tank. And it turned out, yeah, it was just completely fabricated. So it turns out, yeah, we don't have 8 second attention spans. It's much more complicated. Obviously, our attention can be reduced at certain moments.
Mm-hmm.
If you're multitasking, often you do all acts in a way that's half the attention that's needed. Nevertheless, it does show that attention is much more complicated than this. You can, of course, have selective attention, sustained attention, alternating attention, divided attention, something called automatic and controlled attention.
Wow.
I feel like I'm trying to control attention. Auditory,
it feels like that.
Auditory and visual attention. So yeah, I guess with radio, it's only auditory attention. So what I want to do is deep dive a little bit on how to, I guess, create this auditory attention idea. So I've put in a couple of pointers as to firstly what a radio introduction tries to do.
Okay.
So it should be short for one thing. Right, so they say it should be between 10 and 60 seconds. And it's got to introduce the host and give a preview of what's coming up on the show. So they're the basics. It should be short, 10 to 60 seconds. It should introduce the host, which I think we do on our show. And it should give a preview of what's coming up on the show. Sometimes that we don't do that because we're kind of freewheeling it.
But no one can tell.
No. So I want to start with a good example of an introduction.
From a show that already exists?
This is from a show that already exists. And so what we're going to do is we're going to play 10 to 60 seconds of it and think about how do they introduce the host. The main five elements they say should be in a good intro is that it should have a voice.
Well, I suppose.
Yeah. There should be a voice there. There can be music, right? Music can help bring some energy.
Yeah, underneath the voice.
Underneath it. Sound effects can be useful. Yeah. And then some episode information.
Yeah.
Right, what's coming up. And it should be written in a conversational style. Right. So... let's hear this example. This is considered one of a really good example.
Okay.
Want to future-proof your business?
Oh, sorry, that's
accessing
not
up to $15,000 in financial assistance?
No, I can't. Okay, I'm going to talk over it so we're not
advertising.
Maybe I can just
hear it. MIS,
National Incentive. All right, here we go. No. Okay, here we go.
Welcome to StarTalk, your place in the universe where science and pop culture collide. StarTalk begins right now.
I'm gonna play a bit more, but What if that? I mean, you can look on the screen. I've written down the key things.
I can't because my screen's blank. Sorry.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I didn't pay attention to your side. Okay. What was the music?
Yes.
Was there a voice?
Yes.
Was there sound effects?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. So it seemed to have that trifecta. And that was also, what's his name?
Mike Wazowski.
No, the famous scientist guy in the States. Anyway, let's listen to
Neil deGrasse Tyson.
Yes, that's it. Then the host comes on, so we'll see how the host introduces. Good music.
Welcome, 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 ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, kids of all ages, to Star Talk Radio. Bill Nye here, sitting in for Neil deGrasse Tyson, and I'm here today with none other than Chuck Nice.
Hey, Bill.
And we are going to have cosmic queries.
Yeah.
Yep, okay, yep. So, what do you think? It's Bill Nye, it's welcome. Is it conversational?
To me, yeah, it's sort of like it fits everything like that, and it sort of works, but in the end, it still sounds too much like an American sort of like sportscaster show to me.
Maybe that's interesting. Yeah, maybe this is a cultural thing. If a lot of your advice is given by American hype culture, it can become a little cookie cutter in a way in terms of everything's hyped. Well, let's listen to
Hey, everyone, welcome.
That's right, sell yourself.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. You could just say, hello, everybody, and welcome to today's show.
Well, okay, so you're going to love this next example then. So this is about how you can turn a boring point into a big question.
Okay.
Right, so this is going total American.
Big talk.
Big question. So this is an example from NPR, America's big, I think it's publicly funded, National Public Radio.
Oh, right, okay, yeah.
And this is from the Planet Money podcast.
Planet Money.
It's a great podcast, actually. It's really worth listening to. We're going to have a quick excerpt, so hopefully it doesn't ping us for copyright.
Okay.
So, again, pay attention to what type of voice is this? Is there music? Is there sound effects? And how does it do episode info?
And try and determine if I'm going to like it or not.
Yes. Does it stir up your emotions? All right.
And today on the show, we look at matzah as a business. How do you make money manufacturing a dry, fairly flavorless cracker based on a several thousand-year-old recipe that a tiny percentage of the population eats just 1 week a year?
It turns out this very niche industry holds several pretty profound lessons for the economy as a whole. We're going to hear all about it in a minute, but first, of course, the Planet Money Indicator with our own Jacob Goldstein.
So what was the boring story? Do you think they would trying to make into an interesting story?
I wasn't listening. I'm sorry.
You're like, no, I'm not gonna.
Because I'm trying to get. I haven't done anything for my show, so I need.
Oh, really?
I'm just getting that.
This
together.
Is about eight second attention spans. They're a myth, but if you divide your attention, you do everything twice as bad. All right. Fair enough. Okay. So. So this is about crackers, and the interesting thing is, they say,
it was about crackers.
How can you make money?
What sort of crackers are they talking about?
I don't know. I've not had them. Matzah crackers.
So it's like a food stuff, isn't it?
Yep.
Because they don't have Christmas crackers over there, do they? In America.
What's a Christmas cracker? Is that like shortbread?
What are you asking?
We've got fortune cookies.
Are you asking that?
Let's assume that I don't know.
What a Christmas cracker is.
Yeah. Let's just assume.
Okay.
Because we've got senbei, which are kind of Japanese rice crackers.
Yeah.
And you get seaweed flavor and barbecue flavor and...
Christmas crackers that you have over Christmas dinner.
And they are full of Christmas spirit. There's a lot of Christmas spice in them.
So you...
What is it? Is it like a rice cracker?
It's not food.
I mean,
food.
If you didn't know.
It's not food.
Why is it called
cracker? So you
cracker?
Don't know what a rice cracker is.
Oh, are they the things you pop?
Yeah.
You hold them together? They're called crackers.
Yeah. What did you call them? Bonbons.
Oh, yeah. Let's say I called them bonbons. Yeah, I do know that phrase, bonbons. Christmas bonbons. Yeah.
Christmas crackers.
Yes. Okay, yeah. Well, in that sense, I assume it's the word cracker.
Because
not food cracker, but cracker because you pull
explosion,
them and there'll be
crack.
A little bit of...
Yeah, it's got a hat in it and a little toy trinkets. That you don't want.
Yeah.
And a stupid joke.
Well, I don't think that's what they're talking about. All right. So look, what I want to play now, and hopefully this isn't going to trigger playing commercial music, because I'll try to cut it down without the full song. So here we have some other examples of playing intros, which I think we could model our show on.
Okay.
Or at least institute it as examples for everyone at Edge Radio to follow. So as you're listening along at home, is this a good show intro? How is the voice used? How is music used? How are sound effects used? What is the episode information that's there? Is it conversational? I'm going to add some more to this, because these are now taking us into the kind of, you know, should it stir up emotions and involve listeners?
Okay.
All right. So let's go.
If nobody understands you, we do. Slash FM, music for the me generation.
All right, what do you think of that one?
Music for the me generation. To me, actually, that whole thing just sounded like, you know, when you're cruising down the road in GTA 5. It sounds like that to me.
You're so good, because it is from GTA 5.
Really?
Yeah, this is the Flash FM channel on GTA 5. And I love the comments underneath it. It goes like all the stations, they're hoping come to the remake. They're just loving how immersive these radio station intros and the radio stations in their entirety are.
Can't believe I picked that, because I've never listened to that radio show in game. I always
the Flash
listen,
FM.
Yeah, I always listen to Nonstop Pop.
Well, let's see if you've listened to this one.
Okay.
You thought that man was the Don, but he gave you the fever.
Fever 105. Welcome back to Fever 105, Vice City Soul Paradise, with me, Manning the Wheels of Steel.
All right, yep, I think that's the song that
sounds. I really like that one.
Fever 05.
I like the song, and I think that's what it needs to be. If you want to like hit someone's attention, you need to get like the sort of style or music that they like.
Yeah, because at the moment, like, I guess this is our intro. Is that...
There is nothing wrong with your radio.
Is that good?
Do not attempt to adjust the volume.
We are, I mean, it doesn't do any of the things it should.
For the next hour, we will control all that you hear.
I think
hear.
It piques interest.
You are about to experience the knowledge and insights of the medium.
Yeah. Maybe we can work on... One of the things they do say can be a problem with show intros is... It gets old fast, right? Mm-hmm. If you've got a lot of people that listen to your show, they can get a bit old and you want to redo it.
Yeah.
So we've got tons of people listening to our show.
So we need to have like a Christmas theme.
Oh, you and Christmas. Just so far away from it. Anyway, let's listen to this next one for inspiration.
If you can't wear a spandex jumpsuit, what can you do? This is The Rock.
Yep. What do you think of that one? If we're doing a rock show, I mean, it is GTA 5, so it's deliberately performing it. But then it's interesting to say, can we do this in real life?
I think you could. Like you could emulate it at least, and just make it a bit more.
It's
serious.
Not as good. I agree. It's not as good as.
You thought that man was the Don, but he gave you the fever.
Fever 105. Welcome back to Fever 105,
great music.
Vice City Soul Paradise, with me, Manning the Wheels of Steel.
What's a wheel of steel that you're manning?
Vinyl, I think.
Ah, the wheel of steel, the vinyl turntable.
Yeah.
Ah, so much cred there. All right. Well, we need to incorporate some of that language into our intro. Let's listen to another inspiring example.
More mood swings than your pregnant wife. Emotion. 98.3.
Hello, I am Fernando Martinez, and this is Emotion. When I first come to Vice City, I feel all lonely, a man on the outside, a foreigner. Then I say, Fernando, you like to talk a lot? So I get a well-paid job on the radio and begin to make my name as a successful DJ. Now I'm not so lonely, but I never forget my roots. I never forget, and so I always have a soft spot for foreigner. I've been waiting his next.
So, my name is Fernando Martinez.
You
killed my father. Prepare to die.
That's, it does have that Princess Bride kind of vibe. Because he's telling a story, right? So he's doing the show intro, and they do advise you when you're doing intros or a story, mm-hmm. try to do a personal anecdote.
Yeah.
To make it engaging and bring some kind of
yep.
truth to your voice.
Welcome to Media Mothership. I went to the toilet today.
Oh, wow, I was thinking, Media Mothership, I was abducted by aliens earlier this morning. Maybe we could lean into that.
Yeah.
Alien, because, you know, there was a report, actually, I didn't even put into the news cycle, of NASA and the, I think it's the American Air Force disclosing through their think tank they've been doing some new unexplained, unidentified flying object mm-hmm. data. So we could grab that very timely.
A couple of days ago, well, nights ago, I thought the aliens were here.
Hey, aren't you near Kettering? That's the yeah. UFO hotspot yeah. in Tassie.
Kettering incident.
Total Kettering incident.
Yeah. No, I thought there was aliens.
What, like you saw a UFO or just...
Because I heard all of this gunfire outside. And then went outside.
Like War of the Worlds invasion.
Yeah, yeah, there was gunfire there. It sounded like a submachine gun. There was, across the other side of the house, there was, like, north. There was more, like, it sounded like pistol shots. And then to the west, there was also firing as well. Looked into the sky, there were all of this light flashing off the clouds.
What time was this?
It was like about 7:30, 7:50.
Really?
Yeah. And then looked it up, and apparently it was cracker night.
I missed this entirely. Was it just down south?
Yeah, I think it was. And it was just, yeah, people letting off fireworks everywhere.
Did you record this? I mean, you're a radio person.
I did record it.
You did?
But I don't think I've got good audio.
All right. Well, we'll get the AI to clean that up
yeah.
for next week, people. So, yeah, look, what I like about Fernando's is mm-hmm. that it has a conversational style to it, right? He tells a bit of a story. I'm Fernando. I mean, it's very much kind of, I like the Princess Bride kind of reference. I mean, it's got a really dodgy 1980s Vice City joke at the mm-hmm. start, which we wouldn't emulate, but maybe we could come up with a funny joke. I was thinking like Media Mothership, yeah, we come in peace.
Oh, yeah.
And then add something witty after that. Or at the moment on the website, we've got Media Mothership, where radio meets aliens.
Yeah.
which we could have actually in the promo. I like the, yeah, and it has a kind of, I mean, this is the Emotion 98.3 station on GTA.
Mm-hmm.
So it has that kind of emotion landscape. Let's listen to the next one.
Wait, was it 99.3?
98.3.
Oh. So close.
Ah, to us.
Yeah.
That's right, I forgot. We're Edge Radio 99.3. That's Emotion 98.3. Oof, oof, oof. Because we could have just taken that.
Yeah, exactly.
With no problem. Okay, next.
The hottest reggae dance all on up. All the classic tracks from Jamaica. Blue Ark FM.
What do you reckon?
That's pretty good.
Yeah, it's got... It's obviously reggae
yeah.
channel, so I mean, we could think about this for the K-pop show as well. It's got a lot of reggae beats
mm-hmm.
in the background.
It's short and sharp.
Yep.
Puts it together.
Interestingly, yeah, they do say try to get a professional voice mm-hmm. to do it. Like, if you're cheap, do it yourself, but it's better to do it if you can employ a professional.
So we're not professional voices?
Well, I think text-to-voice AI... is a professional voice that we can employ. Let's listen to it again, because it is interesting, because I think it has... Well, I'm thinking, yes, something that's not our voice just to break the monotony.
Okay. The hottest reggae dancehall on up. All the classic tracks from Jamaica. Blue Ark FM.
Because it's got, like, three voices there, I reckon. doing it. All right, let's try the next one. Again, listening to sound effects, music, and the voice.
Okay.
You can't have too much of this funk. We got to funk you to death, Bobble.
Don't know if it goes into it. Oh, yeah. All right, well. Kind of funk.
That was good. Funk. It sort of like put together what was going to be. And
I do have another version of it.
Quite a bit short. Like it didn't introduce things.
I do have a better, longer version of it.
Bringing the antimatter to your S-Droid.
Oh, here we go.
103.2 bobbles. 103.2. Black, white, green grass, blue grass, wheat grass, it all comes together in your tummy, baby. This is funk. This is R&B. This is groove. This is, Space 103.2 bobble. It's like one of those fusion restaurants where they're mixing peanut butter and sushi. Yeah, I said we going on this trip. The funk trip, that is. The boogie trip. It's all on Space 103.2, me and you, Bobble.
So I think that one goes too long.
Yeah, that's true.
The first one went too short. Mm-hmm. That one went too long. Which is just, you think going with a funk groove and a funk voice, like Parliament voice, the Parliament band, Funkatronic Parliament. Anyway, my funk cred just plummeted. would work. And this is interesting because this one is basically a station ID.
Yeah,
it's Space 103.2 station ID for GTA 5 or whichever GTA it is. It has me, but then it has too much kind of rambling. And the whole grass thing starts interesting. He starts going on about grass, and you think, okay, so what's the payoff? But there isn't really a payoff. I can't remember where that joke lands.
Well, the bluegrass.
Ah, which is a genre of music, right? So he's saying, you know, we've got wheat grass, green grass, any grass you want, the blue grass, and then it lists more. Yeah. So I think we could do better than that.
Oh, yeah.
We could do better than that. All right, well, let's listen to another example.
Classic pop hits from the last 30 years.
It's the best music.
100.7 FM. Non-stop pop.
Non-stop pop.
Okay, Los Santos, you're on Non-Stop Pop, dance and pop from the ages. Well, not all of the ages. Nothing Elizabethan, but from the last 30 years. Don't touch the dial. I've always wanted to say that. I've never seen a radio dial apart from in a movie. They don't have them. It's all digital now. Don't go anywhere. Stand still. Dance.
All right, what do you reckon?
Well, that one is my favorite because it's the one that I've heard all the time when I'm driving through Los Santos.
What do you like about that one? That the voice, I mean, she has a kind of British voice, which is a bit surprising in a kind of Los Santos, US setting.
It sort of works. It's a station that I know I'm going to like the music.
Okay, right. Right, you're not really listening for the host.
Yeah.
It's sound effects. There's not really music to that one, so that one doesn't really have a background music, but it does have sound effects. That kind of, it starts with, if I can go back to the start, it starts with that classic radio sound effects space.
Classic pop hits from the last 30 years.
It's the best music.
100 points.
So that kind of dial tone flipping, that kind of sound of changing dials and that voice reverb vibe. So do you think the sound effects are done well here, or do you think they're a bit dated? I mean, they're kind of performing commercial radio. Is that performance something that a community radio station like Edge Radio should ape or parody?
I think so.
All right. Well, let's try that then. Next week, let's try the next example.
Los Santos Rock Radio.
I'm Captain Loggins and you're on a cruise.
So could we sing the intro?
I think we should.
I mean, this one starts with him singing it. So what we're looking for is voice, music, and sound effects. So this one, I think it had sound effects. Let's listen again.
Los Santos Rock Radio.
I'm Captain Loggins and you're on a cruise.
Why does he say, because he's Captain Loggins and you're on a cruise?
Mm-hmm, I think so.
So we could lean into the Doctor
and
the Lord to say you're on something that would have both those occupations there.
Okay.
SMSN now, if you know an occupation that has doctors and lords for reasons unknown. All right, so, okay, we could add that possibly to its music track. I'm still not sure about.
Laszlo.
I'm not the intern, I'm the co-host almost. Besides, I smoke cigarettes.
Yeah, probably Athena 200s. This is the home of rock.
The home of rock.
We need more screaming.
Yeah, this one goes for Well, like 11 minutes, so not fatal. But allegedly in Grand Theft Auto Vice City Stories, Laszlo Jones, who's a co-host, is involved in the actual episode storytelling. So okay, throughout this episode, there are various examples of him kind of being called upon to host. So it's mainly here as an example of, I guess, the voice. So let's listen to another example of Laszlo Jones from GTA game. And what we're looking for here is how to create effective introductions for radio show by using voice, music, and sound effects.
Boring show with a brand new host. Entertaining America with Laszlo.
Welcome to Entertaining America. This is Laszlo. I gotta say it, pardon me, but don't call it a comeback. I've been here for years, just unemployed. But I'm back, running the media. God, I love this West Coast vibe. Everybody here is so laid back and lazy. I'm here with a man who gets paid to talk for a living. It's incredible. What a concept. He's called a rapper. Oglock, how are you?
Oglock!
All right, so anything there we can take away as learning points? Self-deprecating, it's not...
I still like having music behind the speech.
Yeah.
I think that's the main takeaway.
Okay.
All right, Liberty City, this is your talk radio show, Chatterbox, where your opinion matters. Let's go to the phones. Hello.
So I don't really do a chatter talk back.
No.
All right, well, let's listen to another more typical example from GTA.
New music. Some of which is issued on vinyl for people who have lengthy arguments about fidelity and authenticity, while the rest of us just download it. Radio Mirror Park.
So that one has a bit of music in the backing. It has a funny catchphrase. Classic radio voice. We'd need to find a text-to-voice system that could do classic radio voice. But we do it for parody, because what I like about Radio Mirror Park from GTA is the kind of self-deprecating, self-judging humor of it. The what is the phrase about the we play records? I will listen to it again.
New music, some of which is issued on vinyl for people who have lengthy arguments about fidelity and authenticity, while the rest of us just download it. Radio Mirror Park.
What do you like about that one? Do you reckon that one is...
Yeah, because it's funny.
It's funny, yeah. It would date pretty strongly, though.
Would it? Because vinyl's still having a comeback at the moment.
Oh, no, maybe not that, but just, you know, if you put a joke in your intro and you're 30 episodes in and that joke is at the intro. But maybe the thing I think to investigate here about creating introductions to radio is to use this very platform we've got, Media Mothership, to change up our intro for next week, possibly, time permitting, but then for future weeks as well, to try out some new show intros.
Okay, yeah.
We could even try and get a poll up on some social media space to judge it. If we want to risk that.
It's a worthwhile risk.
All right, well, keep listening to Edge Radio. That's been an investigation into how to introduce your radio show or podcast. And what we've been doing is playing some examples from non-radio show, well, two from real radio shows, and then deep diving into GTA as a parody. As a parody.
Another good one to look at, actually, is not GTA, but I've forgotten the name of it.
Fallout.
No, it's along the same sort of lines, though. Saints Row.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they also have got a radio station.
All right. Well, next week we'll follow this up with some more examples from video games, such as Saints Row. Anyway, what we've been investigating is how voice, music, sound effects, and episode information come together to create a engaging, but not necessarily reliant upon attention span, narrative engagement. So keep listening to Edge Radio. Next, we've got K-Pop Unlimited.
Well, you might. I'm still doing working on the music.
And maybe we can work on an intro for the K-Pop show as well.
Okay, yeah. Sounds good.
This has been me, Dr. Craig, joined by Lord Taylor again this week. You can access show notes on the webpage. That's www.mediamothership.com. edgeradio.org.au. You can also get more information by going directly to edgeradio@edgeradio.org.au or listening on 99.3 FM. Keep listening as K-Pop Unlimited is around the corner with DJ TJ
and
DJ CJ.
Yes.
Why is that difficult for me to remember?
Oh, no.
Literally. All right.